Without much ado, Slava, please, over to you.
Excellent, wonderful. Yuri, thank you very much for inviting me to be here with you today to celebrate this amazing achievement. 60 years ago, Yuri Gagarin was sitting in the spacesuit, already being transported from the Cosmonaut Hotel, which it used to be pretty much in the middle of nowhere. And then on the bus, he was transported to the launch site, then suited up, and then sat in the spacesuit for the first time, pretty much going in nowhere. I mean, we had no idea whether or not people actually will survive at that time. So that there were a lot of interesting questions, and it was a successful launch. It was a successful flight, and today we celebrate that the new space era began. My personal story began pretty much very close to that place, to Baikonur, close to Baikonur. I was born in Kazakhstan, so my trajectory started in Kazakhstan as well, only a few hundred kilometers away from the Baikonur launch site. I was launching my rockets at the age 14. My largest rocket was 2 meters, 5 centimeters, 2 stages. Had to build my own propellant, had to build, you know, all the scientific devices that I was able to control the launch remotely. And then, so there was a little passenger. And so that passenger actually flew on my rocket when I was 14 years old. So that was my introduction into the space era. And then I went, my trajectory took me to Moscow. I went into Moscow State University, graduated from Moscow State University with a degree in physics, theoretical physics. And then I decided to try out a different path. And the different path would be to test general relativity in realistic conditions. And those conditions would be in space, of course. And that's why I actually took an appointment at Jet Propulsion Laboratory at Caltech. And I felt that I would stay here in California only for 1 year. And then many years later, I'm still here and I like it here because it's a wonderful place where we can do a lot of interesting things. And we fly, my laboratory essentially is the entire solar system, an entire universe. And today we'll be talking about something quite interesting, looking for life in the universe. And so so let me move on from this wonderful picture, which is of high value for me personally, but then let me go to a different story. So let me move this. Let me ask you a question. How many of you think that there is life outside the Earth atmosphere? So we know that we have life here on Earth, and life is wonderful. New Zealand is an amazing place. I've been traveling in Australia. I've been to French Polynesia. It's amazing. But how many of you think that there is life outside Earth atmosphere even?
I would say yes.
And
it's surprising if not.
And you're perfectly correct. This is life. This is our current life on the space station. So you see here two of my friends, they're vertically oriented, vertically down, Sergei Ryzhansky. And to the left from him, Alexander Mizurkin, to my friends who were on the space station on the same floor, on the same crew in 2018, essentially two different crews. Sergei was the commander of Soyuz and Alexander was the commander of a space station at that time. So the glove I showed to you was Alexander's. When he was working, he had 3 extravehicular activities outside the space station. And so he was using that glove to actually fix other things. And here, Paolo Nespoli, Mark van der Hei, Randy Bresnik. So these are also friends whom I met through this space program, and they interacted very well with many of them. So, but this is our life in around Earth. So we do have life on Earth, and life is outside Earth atmosphere. But looking for life further. So this is the picture that was taken by by Alexander Mizurkin. You can see here. This is taken from Kupola. In Kupola on the space station, there is a place where you can actually look down and admire the view of the Earth. Here you see Sputnik. This is how we start flying in space, right? So then you see here Soyuz launch as a spacecraft, right? And so Soyuz at that time, it was about 3 years ago, this is what we used to fly to space. And of course, the next one is Enterprise. So the Enterprise is, you know, Star Trek. This is how we think we will fly in the future. And I think now we need to sort of between Soyuz and Enterprise, we need to put Dragon as well. So Dragon is also will be sort of delivering people to the space station. But in the future, basically we go in explore universe. So we began space era only 60 years ago, and now we accomplished a lot of interesting things. Let me actually move to the main topic of my presentation today. NASA Advanced Innovative Concept Institute, which is within NASA headquarters, is funding an interesting project which I'm leading. That is the project that is aiming to image nearby exoplanets using gravitational field of our own sun. And that is quite interesting. And I will talk about this today because there are no other technologies that may help us to actually deliver direct images of exoplanets. We can discover many of them, but to really see those surfaces of those objects, it's pretty much impossible. But before getting there, let me maybe bring this little video here, just to remind that we are all still kids at heart.
You ever wonder what's up there? Like what? Maybe someone up there was wondering what it's like here. I guess. Do you think we'll ever meet them? I hope so. Don't you?
I also hope we can meet them. I also hope that there are some, not human, but there are some life forms that exist on maybe, in the around on nearby stars, on the planet, on the planet that orbit nearby star. And at some point, our civilization will be able to actually develop and establish contact with those alien worlds. But how can we contemplate that? How can actually we consider traveling to those distances? And that is difficult. But let me tell you just a few facts. And this is our family portrait. This is our solar system. And as Konstantin Tsiolkovsky once said, that this is our cradle, the cradle of our the humanity. And at some point we grow up, we leave this cradle, we'll go further. And so, but this is the family portrait. This is our solar system. This is what we know very, very well. And we explored this extremely well by now. I think Yuri is very familiar with this picture. So, but this is our solar system. And you see, we have flown many missions. And many missions to pretty much every celestial body forming solar system. So we visited every planet and we visited many satellites. So, and we, one of the main topics that drives this exploration is search for life, of course. And so we do expect that we will find microbial life on Mars. And so maybe even the rover that is currently operating on the Martian surface will be able to deliver unique data to tell us that maybe there used to be life on Mars. There may be some life forms that left the signature of life, or maybe even current life, because we know that there is water on Mars now, and we know that water is actually flowing when there is a sun on Mars. It's on the surface of Mars. So essentially, we expect that we'll find life, some kind of resemblance of life on Mars. Maybe microbial, maybe bacterial, but there are other places in the solar system. The two satellites of Jupiter, Europa and Ganymede, and one satellite of Saturn, Enceladus, where we expect to find found unique conditions. On Europa, there is a very thick layer of ice, and that ice actually sits on top of very, very deep ocean. And so once we'll get there at some point, we'll land our spacecraft, we'll be able to drill that thick layer of ice, which is about a kilometer thick. It's not a simple, it's like drilling in Antarctica, right? So it's a similar how to drill there. The technology that we expect to be useful there is basically melting ice. We can use a radioisotope thermal generator that will be placed on the surface of that, of the ice, will be melted through. And then at some point, that probe will break through the ice, and we will be able to fly, maybe not fly, but actually use a little submarine there that can actually explore the life or maybe sort of the world which is under the ice in Europa. There is interesting there are interesting conditions around Enceladus, where geysers of water so exist on the surface. And we, the Cassini spacecraft, visited this interesting satellite several times, and took some samples of that liquid that is going through those vents in Enceladus, and this is water, and essentially this is amazing. So we can also get our spacecraft there and try to understand whether or not there is some life form may exist on those satellites. So this is the four places in our solar system where we can hope to find some signs of life, maybe even current life as we speak. But there are no those green men that we all look for. So there is no green man on Mars. There is nothing out there. And so where is life? Where is intelligent life? And this is why we look at the heavens. And so as you know, as you're aware, for the last 20 years, the new branch in astronomy had opened. And that branch is exoplanet research. In 1992, the two Swiss scientists were able to detect the presence of a very large planet orbiting a nearby star. And so a few years ago, they got Nobel Prize for the discovery of the planet orbiting the sun-like star. And so the Pegasi 51. And so the two gentlemen actually received Nobel Prize for confirming that there are plenty of planets out there. And so we know that the star formation process is ongoing, and there are many stars that are being formed as we speak within our galaxy. And really there are about five new planetary systems are formed every year. There may be 5 to 50 new planets every year born in the galaxy. And so by now we expect to see at least maybe 50 billion to 5 trillion of planets only within our galaxy alone. So planets are ubiquitous, they're everywhere. And what we actually see through the data that is delivered by our spacecraft, TESS, and before that it was a Kepler spacecraft, we were able to discover many exoplanets. As of today, we have confirmed 4,375 exoplanets, and there are many planetary systems, over 3,000 planetary systems. There are 165 planets that have solid surface, and which is amazing. So as I monitor this data, I realize that this data is changing pretty much weekly, on a weekly basis. There will be a few more spacecraft launch this year, and maybe the next year, at 22, those spacecraft in a few years will multiply the number of the confirmed planets by a factor of 10. So at some point we have hundreds of thousands of exoplanets discovered. That means the next step is to look for the planet that resembles our own. So when we will be able to detect Earth 2.0, what do we do next? So it's not a matter of if we discover, it's a matter of when. It's the question of when we will be able to discover that planet that resembles our own Earth. And maybe that planet will orbit a similar star, such as our own sun, and maybe it will have a very regular orbit as our own planet. See, our planet has a very very regular orbit. It's not inclined, it's not elongated, it's not very elliptical. So eccentricity of that orbit is pretty much negligible. And so the thermal environment on the planet is uniform. And that allows for biological processes to evolve for many millions of years. So the boring orbit is a good factor for us to exist, essentially. And but we are looking for those exoplanets, and at some point we'll be able to find this Earth 2.0. But what do we do next? Flying there to that exoplanet will take a lot of time. And so traveling there we cannot think about traveling there probably within the next two, maybe 300 years. We can explore solar system, but interstellar travel is still something that our civilization is yet to do. And our estimates is it probably will take maybe 200 to 250 years before our civilization will be able to fly into those vast regions of space. And maybe by then our, you know, human species will evolve, and so we will be able to live in space. And so something like that will be possible, but not within our lifetimes, unfortunately. But we all want to see surfaces of those exoplanets. What do we do? This is our neighborhood. This is our stellar neighborhood within just only 100 light years from us. And so what is a light year is the distance that the light travels within 1 year, which is a very large distance, essentially. Within this distance, within the 100 light years, there are at least 3,000 exoplanets already confirmed. And we expect there will be many more of those exoplanets just in our neighborhood. What do we do to study them and to see maybe their surfaces? So this is very difficult, but we have a fleet of missions. So those missions you see on the left, we started from Hubble, Spitzer, Kepler, TESS. TESS is currently operating. It's the Kepler mission used to be operational up until recently. Kepler was a very productive mission, finding many exoplanets. TESS now is operating and brings a lot of exciting news quite often, discovering new exoplanets. By now, I think TESS was launched only a year and a half ago, and by now it was able to discover about 4,000 exoplanetary candidates. So in a few years, we'll have many more planets to be discovered by missions like WFIRST, and then the James Webb spacecraft will be launched next year. So there will be plenty more spacecraft data. But this is very impressive, but none of those missions will be able to actually see the exoplanet directly. What they will tell us is that around a certain star, there is indirect evidence for a planet to exist, because the planets are very small. They're very difficult to see them on the background of those stars that they orbit. So it's very difficult to see the exoplanets. But in fact, one you can compare a discovery of exoplanet is like if you are observing a firefly on the background next to a searchlight. You have a very bright searchlight, and you have a firefly which is very tiny, very dim, very faint, and it's very difficult to see anything like that. And so what we do, we really study something called stellar wobble, because the planet and its own star, they orbit around each other. And the star wobbles, the position of that star changes on the sky, and periodically changes under gravitational pull of the exoplanet. And that's how we observe those exoplanets. Some exoplanets have a very unique orbit, so that they will travel, they will cross the distance between us and their star. They will transit through the face of those stars, and then we'll see how brightness of that star will change periodically, and therefore that will allow us to confirm that there is an exoplanet around that star. And this is how majority of exoplanets are being discovered, but that's not the way to actually build a direct image of those exoplanets. This is no way to do this with classical telescope. In fact, this is our main problem. It's, you see our own star, the sun is here, and our tiny, tiny planet, Earth, is down there. This is a very small planet object compared to the sun. And the Earth does not emit light. It only reflects light. So only the sun that is emitting light, all the other planets in our solar system do not emit, they just reflect light. So they're very dim. Not only this, but also distances matter. So not only size, but distances. This is wonderful selfie that the Cassini spacecraft took of each of us. So Cassini spacecraft orbiting Saturn took a picture of Earth. So this arrow shows here the planet Earth. So this is you and me, this is us, this is a selfie of us. And so the distances are very large. And to take those images, it requires a very unique cameras to be built. So with the traditional telescope, it's very difficult to actually see beyond beyond Pluto to see, to make very, very detailed image of any object. But the challenge is, if I want to have just one pixel image of an exoplanet, if I take our own Earth and I put it at 100 light years away, and I want to take the image of that exoplanet with just one pixel, so the whole, my sensor on the telescope will occupy just one pixel. The diameter of the telescope I need to have should be at least 90 kilometers. So just think about it. If I want to make an image, we all have our cell phones, and the cell phones usually have what, maybe megapixel sensor, the sensor in their focal plane. And so we used to have high resolution images of everything that we take pictures of. And so, but this is only one pixel. And for one pixel, I need to have access to a telescope which is 90 kilometer in diameter. And this is almost impossible to build because, see, if you've been to Los Angeles, here I show Jet Propulsion Laboratory right here in the middle of the picture, and down there, Dana Point. It's a wonderful resort town. If you want to visit there, it's nice to be to see, I mean, the California life. But 90 kilometers is only 10 kilometers shy from the altitude of space, the boundary to space. It's a very large structure. So if at some point humanity will be able to build something like that, this structure will have to be built in space, and it will weigh trillions of tons. It's an extremely heavy structure. And so if you were to build it, solar radiation pressure, the solar light will just remove that object from the solar system within 1 year, because it's a large sail. It's like a sailboat, essentially. You built a big sail up there, and the solar radiation pressures, solar photons, will be pushing it out. And essentially, that object will be removed from the solar system within just 1 year. So building a telescope like this, it's not really feasible. It's not really possible within the reasonable time frame. What can we do really in space, and what can we do on the ground? So we actually want to have something like this. We used to have images of planets and our own planet with the resolution like this. So this is 2002 blue marble image of our own planet with about 10,000 by 10,000 pixels. It would be nice to have something like that of exoplanet, even the nearby exoplanet. Maybe just within 100 light years. But as I said, for just one pixel, the size of the telescope must be very large. If I want to have, let's say, 100 pixels, multiply the diameter by 100, by a factor of 100. So the more pixels you want to have, multiply by that number of pixels. So it's impossible. So what can we do today? This is the slide shows what can we do currently. On the right, you see a number of telescopes that were built for astronomy within the last 150 years. It includes telescopes like on Mount Wilson here in Los Angeles, telescopes on Hawaii, Subaru, Gemini, Keck telescopes. So they are on a scale of about 10 meter size. The largest telescope that we built on the ground, shown here within the red circle. So this is showing on the left. It's a European extremely large telescope that is 39 meters. So 39 meters, this telescope will be commissioned only next year, 2022. And it cost quite a bit of money. So, but still it's 39 meters. And so the large radio telescope, I think Arecibo telescope is shown here like a gray circle here. So Arecibo that used to provide very exciting images. Oh, it's excellent, I'm sorry, it's Arecibo is right there. See, Arecibo is showing just a little arc down this picture. It's just showing the curvature. It used to be what is 200 meters in diameter. So, but it's a radio telescope. So these are the telescopes that we can build today on the ground. What can we do in space? In space, we cannot do more. So essentially the largest telescope that we're all familiar with is Hubble telescope. The Hubble size is only 2.4 meters. So the James Webb telescope that will be launched next year will be 6.5 meters. So there is no way within our lifetime we can actually contemplate something like 90 kilometers. It's impossible. So this is why we are now turning back to some other physics that may help us to build something like that. And that is general theory of relativity. Here you see Einstein sitting with Eddington in 2030, sitting in Cambridge on, together, because Einstein suggested that according to general theory of relativity, light, when it travels around massive body, will change its trajectory from rectilinear and it will be deflected. And so it's a very tiny deflection angle. And so, but deflection angle is roughly 1.75 arc seconds. This is very small. And essentially, if I take the two light rays that will be enveloping the sun from two different sides, the two rays will meet at the distance of roughly 550 astronomical units away. So this is where the focal area of that gravitational telescope would begin. But I'm running ahead a little bit. So here, the Eddington and Einstein sit here after Eddington conducted first experiment to confirm that general relativity is a correct theory and as it describes light propagation in the solar system. And this telegram almost 100 years ago confirming that indeed general theory of relativity was a valid description of light propagation in the solar vicinity. Today, so we know that Einstein was the first one who actually came up with the gravitational lens equations. And those equations were written just over 100 years ago. But back then we didn't have access to technologies, essentially. Those technologies that will help us to build the telescopes and to fly missions. There was no space. Access to space. In 1919, there was no access to space. We started to think about using space for this purpose only when Voyager spacecraft, which is now operating at the distance of roughly 150 astronomical units away. Astronomical unit is the distance between the sun and the Earth. So the light travels from the sun to Earth, it takes 8 minutes. It takes almost 16 hours for the light to travel from Earth to Voyager. That's how far that object is today. So, but now we realize that with Voyager, actually, we can consider flying in a very deep regions of the solar system. And so how we do that, and we have chemical propulsion, we have multiple other means, but now we can consider using solar gravitational lens as the mean to actually study, to use it as a telescope, as a part of the telescope. So, coming back to gravitational lensing, we know that gravitational lensing now is confirmed pretty much everywhere. So this is a wonderful picture taken by Hubble spacecraft showing Einstein arcs that do exist in the universe. And we quite often use them to study distribution of dark matter, studying distribution of galaxies. And this is amazing, a very precise tool that actually helps us to understand how our universe evolves and what is it, study the structure of our universe. But our laboratory, my laboratory essentially is the entire solar system. So my interest is to fly spacecraft in the solar system and try to understand how we can benefit from gravitational field and how we can test general relativity, how we can use it. So now I'm turning the table and I'm saying that general relativity now is an applied discipline. And so can we use it and what can we use it for? And it turned out that basically, if we use the sun, our sun as a lens, the lens that allows for light, you know, when light travels around, if you look down here, this picture, the bottom of this picture, when the light rays are traveling around the sun, their trajectory will be bent. And so the light rays will intersect at a very large distance, roughly 550 from the sun. Once they will intersect, essentially the gravity of the sun will act as a lens. And so there will be very narrow pencil beam, a pencil sharp beam area around the optical axis here where the light amplification is really humongous. We're talking about 10 to the 11th. So it's a very significant light amplification that is driven by the mass of the sun. And the mass of the sun is very significant. It allows for the light trajectories to bend enough and actually focusing light, amplifying its brightness by 11 orders of magnitude, which is unique. So this is good, but how to get there? To get there is very difficult because we need to fly very, very far and we need to operate spacecraft in this region. So here on the top part of this picture, you see that the sun is on the left, and our nearby star is Alpha Centauri. It's a logarithmic scale. It's conveniently done in logarithmic scale. So, but you realize that once you go through the boundary of the solar system, which is roughly 120 astronomical units away, there is nothing out there. It's pretty much empty space. So once you go away out from the solar system, you see here, Voyager 1 spacecraft is shown here, Voyager 2 spacecraft is here. Solar gravitational lens is conveniently placed in the middle of this figure. But this is only the scale that takes us all the way to our nearby star, the Alpha Centauri. And so that's the challenge, how to get there. Already we have those Voyagers here, and we are contemplating multiple missions that will take us beyond 200 astronomical units away, but we need to go further. So essentially, if we have a 1 meter telescope on this, if you fly a spacecraft to this region, and if that spacecraft has a 1 meter telescope, and we are able to block the sun with instrument called coronagraph, we will be able to benefit from the significant light amplification that is provided by solar gravitational lens. And this is what we actually are studying within our mission development effort here at Jet Propulsion Laboratory. So just a few numbers to show the amplification factor is really 10 to the 11th. And our own Earth, which is if you place an object similar to our own Earth at 100 light years away, the image of that object will be compressed and will be only occupying a cylinder with a diameter of 1.3 kilometers. So if I place a spacecraft within the 1.3 kilometers diameter and will be able to move pixel by pixel, I will be able to collect enough brightness data and use that data to actually recover image of the exoplanet. And that's the objective. I'm not going to show any more questions, but this is something, I think it was just important to show that indeed, there is a lot of light out there, and actually we can benefit from the solar gravitational lensing to build exoplanet images. Once we get to that distance, we will be able to, if we positioned our spacecraft very well with respect to the target, then we will see something called Einstein ring. And the entire image of the exoplanet will now be within this Einstein ring. So that the telescope that is looking back at the sun, it will see the image of the exoplanet within the Einstein ring. Our purpose is really to collect the data on the brightness of that ring and then reconstruct it. So, but we block the sun with coronagraph, and then basically we collect the light as we want. So the brightness of the Einstein ring is rather significant. And so once we get the full ring, it will tell us a lot of information about how the surface is structured. Let me show how it actually formed. So here, our telescope is looking back at the sun, and the solar diameter is shown here with the yellow circle. Einstein ring from the exoplanet is formed around the sun. And so our purpose is, our idea is actually once we block the sun with the coronagraph, so the solar brightness, the solar corona is not shown through in the telescope, we will be able to collect the brightness of that Einstein ring and collect needed in the information that we need. So now what you see here is the simulation where our spacecraft is moving towards that optical axis. And then once it reaches the optical axis, it's actually forming now the Einstein ring. So at different distances, if we go further, let's say 650 AU, the Einstein ring will be formed a little bit further away from the solar photosphere. If you go even further, so to 900 AU, so then you see how the we are approaching the center of the sun, and we see how the arcs are being formed. And so the arcs are formed, and with this formation, at some point, you will see the full Einstein ring formed around the sun. And so once we travel within the image, we collect the data. And the data allows us to actually to image the exoplanet. Let me show how it's done. So this is the simulation showing how actually we move the spacecraft and how long do we need to integrate the signal, how long do we need to collect the data. And so that's again, another simulation showing how the brightness on the sensor of the telescope is increasing. If you've seen the, so you will see how as we approach the optical axis, you see how the two spots that we see initially will start forming an Einstein ring on the sensor. And so once we reach that position, we will stay within the within this image, and we will be able to actually get the data. So that's how, once we reach the full circle, that means we're exactly on the optical axis, and we will be able to stay within that position to collect the needed information. The lens is not really perfect. The solar lens is not perfect. It has a significant spherical aberration. If I take our own Earth and put it together, put it through the solar gravitational lens, I will see that blurred image of our own planet. So this is the image that will be produced by our solar gravitational lens at this distance of 550 astronomical units away from the sun. So you can kind of see continental lines. You can kind of, you know, see some color changes, weather patterns, but the image is blurred. But it's not bad because once I collect the brightness information, when my spacecraft travels pixel by pixel, I will be able to recover that information. And that's what I can have. So I do the image reconstruction, and ultimately I'm getting something like this, which is quite remarkable. So I can remove all the blur from the previous image that used to be here. I actually will sharpen the glasses on the solar gravitational lens so that, you know, so that I will be able to actually have images of our own of the exoplanet with very as sharp as possible. So essentially, we are talking about ultimately the imaging can be done with the resolution of about 25 kilometers on the surface of the exoplanet. So imagine that if I have pixel sizes of 25 kilometers on the surface of the exoplanet, which is situated 100 light years away from us. That means I can see continental lines, weather patterns, I can see topography, I can actually see, the cities, if they build there, there will be some patterns, there will be oceans, there will be ice caps. So we can tell a lot about current conditions that now exist on that exoplanet. And without traveling to that exoplanet, we will be able to tell a lot about the present conditions on that exoplanet. And so, but in addition to imaging, we can do actually spectroscopic investigations. With spectroscopy, using the same information from the amplified light from exoplanet, with spectroscopy, I can study the presence of oxygen, nitrogen, methane on that exoplanet. And I will definitely be able to identify where the ozone line begins and within the spectrum. And so we will be able to tell whether or not there is some, you know, the ongoing biological conditions exist on that exoplanet. And so that will be amazing because now we can correlate the data, imaging data with the spectroscopic data, and we can identify where, you know, where the ocean is, where, you know, some life, some you know, forests are, where deserts, and what the actual life look like. Because what I'm describing is the familiar natural patterns that we see here on our own planet. But how those patterns will be present at that planet, we don't know. So really just looking for at the exoplanet with this resolution, multi-pixel resolution, we're talking about at least 600 pixels across. So 600 by 600 pixel resolution of the exoplanet. So that is the information that we can get within using the solar gravitational lens as the means to amplify light. But of course, to get there, it's not that simple. Our sun is very bright. And we have not only the sun, but it has solar corona. And so to get there, we actually need to build instrument that will be flown with the telescope called coronagraph. So we have a design, excellent design for the coronagraph that essentially will allow to block solar brightness, the brightness of our own sun to a very high degree. And so then only solar corona will be shining through. And even with that, we will be able, on the background of very bright sun, we will be able to reconstruct are very interesting images of those objects. And I'm talking about 100 light years away, it's just as an example. Of course, our neighbor at only 4.3 light years away from us, Alpha Centauri, Proxima Centauri, where recently an exoplanet was discovered. We should be able to see that exoplanet with the image of that exoplanet will be about 30 kilometers across, not 1.3 kilometers, but 30 kilometers across. We'll be able to travel within that image. We'll be able to collect enough data to confirm or disprove whether or not that planet is habitable now. And so whatever of what life conditions exist on that nearby planet. And of course, from that our stellar neighbor all the way to the probably 200 light years away from us, the solar gravitational lens provides a very unusual, unexpected help for us to actually look for those life signs beyond the solar system, beyond our own atmosphere, and really in our stellar neighborhood. So that puts us in the position to start thinking not only about all our own life, but actually what do we do once we will meet that alien life? How do we study it? And there will be no contact with that life because there is no way to travel there yet. But still, we will be able to see how this life evolves on that exoplanet. Do they use the same carbon fuel as us on this planet? Do they use different technology? How do they evolve? So a lot of interesting information will come helping us maybe on this planet to live different life. So that will be very, very interesting. But how do we get there? To get to the solar gravitational lens focus area, the main challenge, of course, is the distance. Our most distant spacecraft that we have flown to date is Voyager 1. Voyager 1 was launched in 1972, and the primary mission included going around the nearby planets, so traveling to Jupiter, Saturn, and essentially going through asteroid belt for the first time, and after Pioneer 10 and Pioneer 11. So that actually it was a very interesting period where the exploration of the outer solar system was just initiated. So, but Voyager survived the primary mission and is still transmitting data from the distance of 152 astronomical units away. So the 1970s technology is still operational and still transmits kilobits of data as a deep space network contacts with the spacecraft. And so essentially that gives us and a good example that yes, we can build we can have technology that actually will allow us to travel that far. But the far is not the only question. Realistically, we would like to fly a mission that can deliver data, useful data within the lifetime of a scientist. So we don't want to go there to 200 to 500 EU and with the mission that will be more than 100 years. So ideally, if that mission will fly within 25 years, that would be nice. So that pushes the velocity that we want to have to a region of roughly above 20 astronomical units per year. Until recently, the largest velocity that was achieved in the interplanetary flight was that of New Horizons spacecraft and a mission to Pluto. New Horizons was launched on Atlas. A launch vehicle went directly all the way to Jupiter. It crossed the orbit of the moon first and reached Jupiter in just 1 year. It was a direct flight, was a very powerful rocket. And during that flight, that was the sort of the speed record was achieved. And the speed record was only 3 astronomical units per year. So we are talking about flying 20, 25 AU per year. And you can see on that list that chemical propulsion will allow us to reach maybe 15 AU per year. So solar thermal, when you fly nearby the sun and the solar heat will actually provide you with additional kick to provide you with solar thermal propulsion, maybe 22 AU per year. But going there, it will require significant thermal shielding because we need to fly to very close to the sun within 2 to 3 solar radii, which is very difficult. Then nuclear electric propulsion, technology readiness level of other technologies is not very high. Realistically, it may take maybe up to 20 years before those technologies will be feasible. This is why we think the reasonable way to do this, it would be actually using are solar sails. And with solar sails, we can fly a very small spacecraft. And you are perfectly aware with the success of Rocket Lab in New Zealand, how small spacecraft can be launched. And small spacecraft now taking a significant role by monitoring our own planet and exploring solar system. But with that is ongoing revolution and miniaturization of spacecraft. Solar sails are now are being flown by a number of organizations. The recent one was by the Planetary Society, and the upcoming flight will be Neo Scout, built by Marshall Space Flight Center. So those sails are planar sails, and they will be able to reach very high velocity, up to 20 astronomical units per year. We will go from it with a different design. So essentially, how solar sails work? The solar radiation pressure, which is basically includes primarily photons that are falling onto the sail and actually transferring momentum and accelerating that sail to very large velocity. It's like a sailboat. You can go with the sailboat against the wind because you have a rudder, you have a sail, and the boat can go against the wind. With a solar sail, and you can go against the wind as well. And that's how we'll do it. This is our choice for the spacecraft. We're using not a planar spacecraft, but rather we have vanes. And by articulating vanes, we can actually go against the wind. We can fall on, we can be launched. We are thinking about a rideshare launch using maybe Falcon or maybe, you know, one of the SpaceX's or Blue Origin's launch vehicles that are being built. Essentially, there are plenty of interesting launch vehicles available. So, but rideshare can take us to the Earth orbit. And then within roughly 5 months, going from the high Earth orbit, we're going all the way to solar perihelion. And then we will be propelled by very large velocity. And so with the solar radiation pressure, we should be able to reach velocities of 20 to 25 astronomical units per year and get to the solar gravitational lens of focal area within roughly 24 to 25 years. From getting to the perihelion. So we are now building something called technology demonstration mission. Of course, our objective is to demonstrate a number of technologies that will be used to fly this mission. And our primary objective is to get to the solar gravitational lens region in a very short time. We're talking about 20 to 30 years. And so within 20 to 30 years, we need to fly fast. And that's a technology demonstration mission that we are building now is using vane spacecraft. Our idea is that we'll be able to fly a reasonably inexpensive spacecraft. The total mission cost will be on a scale of roughly $20 to $25 million. The full mission, that mission will be able to demonstrate very large velocity of roughly 5 astronomical units per year. This will be our first step. And then that mission, that technology can be used to explore our own solar system, to visit with those interesting planets and satellites at a very inexpensively. And you're probably also aware that our solar system was visited by a number of interstellar visitors recently. An interstellar asteroid, Oumuamua, was actually flying still through the solar system. And there is an interstellar comet. We can fly this spacecraft that you see on this picture to actually explore those interstellar visitors because they move very fast. And with this technology, we can catch them up and maybe, you know, study them in situ. And that will be amazing because with this technology, we can actually study not only our own solar system, we can develop and populate, you know, deep regions of the solar system with instruments that will be able to monitor behavior of the solar system objects and actually tell us more about our own sun. And so that's what we are doing now. The mission, we expect that this mission will be built within the next year and a half, and hopefully we'll fly it by year 2024. And so that's how this mission will actually, the trajectory for that mission. So we'll fly from a rideshare launched by SpaceX. And after that, we basically deploy sails and start falling onto the sun. Within about 6 months, we reach solar perihelion distance at the distance of roughly 15 solar radii. And then we just turn in sails and we are starting to fly away from the solar system at very high velocity. That's the way to travel because with the solar sailing, we don't really constrained to solar system ecliptic plane where all the planets are moving. We can actually fly anywhere at our will, at our choice, perpendicular to the solar system ecliptic plane, or go anywhere we want. And that's a very that's actually a very interesting technology that is now being going through a renaissance, actually a revolution, I would say, because miniaturization of spacecraft. You can put a lot of solar cells on the sail structure so that you will be able to charge your batteries. The power is not a problem. You can fly maybe radioisotope thermal generators, sort of nuclear power on board. You can use those sails for communication purposes because potentially you can form them as a large radio antenna. You can communicate with deep space antenna on the ground. And essentially with this type of spacecraft, you can explore solar system faster, better, and cheaper, because I don't know any mission today that actually was flown beyond the asteroid belt that cost less than $2 billion. That's not the way to explore solar system. It's too expensive. It takes a lot of time to do it. So, but flying a small spacecraft like drones, like those drones which I show here, we consider this like a drone. And drone can do a sort of scout work. And after that, the main class sort of major mission can go after to explore solar system. But for our purpose, we will be able to build those spacecraft and then test technologies and actually verify them so that we will actually have a very good successful transition strategy, enable our transition strategy. Here, our effort is still ongoing. By 2022, we will be able to build the public-private partnership to start building those spacecraft and then start flying those sailcraft at a very inexpensive sailcraft. That will allow us to mature technology, to mature technology, and then to begin the proper solar gravitational lens project sometime in the early 2030s. And so we hope that by the year of 2060, we should be able to deliver first image, high resolution image of alien world. So that will be a transformational moment for the humanity, because not only we will be able to confirm life, but actually bring the images of a very different life form that exists elsewhere in the universe. So technology exists, multiple layers of technology exist. There are no major showstopper here. And it's really, we're going methodically step by step, building pieces together. And so hopefully that by the year 2030, we should be able to initiate the construction of the project, and we will fly this project by year to 2056. And as I said, we'll deliver very interesting data within 40 years from now. The challenge here, of course, how to run the large project like this. In the history of civilization, we know that those projects did exist. The Chinese Great Wall of China, the pyramids, Egyptian pyramids. So there were different ways of organizing those projects, right? So organizational skills that are required to build those humongous projects were different. Now we need to actually generate excitement. We need to bring a lot of industry into the mix. And that's what we're doing now. We're building a private-public partnership here in the United States that will allow us to effectively to start testing the technologies and build the needed components of those technologies, so that ultimately we'll see pictures like this. And so this is our Earth just in a wavelength. It's how a human eye is actually changing. It's in real colors. So this is in real colors because human eye actually adjusts colors, because we don't see all the colors in the rainbow uniformly. So this is sort of a machine vision, essentially. The true color is here. But this is what we hope to be able to see when we receive the data from that probe in 40 years from today. That will be taking data of the image of that exoplanet. So on this note, I'd like to finish my presentation today, and I hope you liked it. And essentially, I invite you to consider maybe doing something together on this front, because I know that science and technology in New Zealand are very, very aggressive and very interesting. So there are lots of interesting companies exist, and I hope we can do something together within this front. So thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them.
Thank you, Slava. That was fantastic. I have a question, actually. If I choose a star nearby, within a few light years away, probably slightly far away than Proxima Centauri, and try to locate an area in proximity of Earth that is actually a focal point for gravitational lens that this star is creating. So can I try to, you know, moving my vehicle around, find a spot and see the image of some planet?
Yes, you can do that. The challenge there is that gravitational lensing or any lensing requires alignment. And so alignment, when you do alignment with the other celestial bodies, this alignment is very temporary. So because everything is moving in the universe, right? So everything is, you need to be able to put your spacecraft exactly or where this alignment is. In case of solar gravitational lens, we engineer this alignment. With other celestial bodies, we cannot actually really nail them to the sky and ask them to stay, they move. And so microlensing events, we register those microlensing events pretty much using instruments on Earth. But those events are rare alignments. They usually happened within a time scale of a month. So within 2 weeks, you will see how brightness of certain objects increases and then decreases because there was alignment and then misalignment. So that's kind of aligning celestial bodies probably beyond the human capability yet. So, but really space, building a spacecraft and then flying a spacecraft, I think that it
is. Well, then, yeah, I don't need to move as far as in the other model, right? So, but the blinking star is actually the same, isn't it? The gravitational lens effect or not?
Blinking stars?
Yes. Can it be attributed to a gravitational lens alignment effect?
Which star do you mean?
Yeah, just in general, a star that blinks.
Oh, blinking star is light because effect. So this is our atmosphere, because the light
goes through, I understand that, right?
Because the light goes through the atmosphere, right? And so atmosphere, so the wavelength of light and it interacts with the structure of the upper atmosphere, and essentially that's what creates that. This is why when you see the planet in the solar system, that planet is not twinkling, right? So only stars do twinkle. When you see the planet, your eye averages this twinkling effect, averages, and we don't see it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. Right. Any questions, guys?
Yeah, I have a question and a comment. Hi, this is Eric Dahlstrom. One comment was that we recently watched Neil deGrasse Tyson's Cosmos 2 series again. And I was realizing that this was the one project that he got very excited about. And I thought that was really exciting for all the segments of the series that he picked this one out and said, we've got to do this right now. And that was a really good endorsement. I'm really impressed by your precursor little drone there that, did I read that right on your slide that your little test equipment is only total mass is only 5 kilograms? Is that
absolutely
right?
This, is extremely light.
This so is like whole... a solar explorer. You could have so many of these things probing.
That's the whole idea, exactly. This is a small drone, right? So think about those drones. We have helicopter drones. They're inexpensive. They're throwaway drones, right? So here, the weight of this system is extremely light. And so essentially what we have here is articulating the vanes. You can organize a travel from high Earth orbit all the way to the moon and back. It's like an Amazon delivery truck. And so you go in and out. You have solar cells on the vanes of this structure. The power is abundant. Communication, you can form the vanes in such a way so that communication between Earth and that structure. So I expect we will see many of them soon within around Earth. going in the solar system, it's different. But you're right, it's very inexpensive. We actually consider, I didn't show lots of slides, but really, you know, when we do rideshare, we fly 30 of them because they're so light. And so area to mass ratio is the key parameter. The larger the area, the smaller the mass, you get the larger force acting on the structure. And so, this is extremely light.
Oh, this is wonderful. I can't wait to see these things fly. That would be wonderful.
Come visit us in California. We'll just show you how things are done. And in fact, we're already building the vanes. So the vanes, lifting them with your finger, it's amazing. It's a gossamer structure. Oh, so okay. Everything is, all the masses are here. And so essentially the total mass is only less than, 5.5 kilos. And so as it flies, it will be sort of stowed in the fairing, stowed in sort of all the vanes will be compressed. Once it gets out, essentially it unfolds and fixes in place. And that's all what we want.
Wow.
So yes, indeed, we are trying to change something. You know, it's a good time now for solar sailing because many people tried in the past and many people were trying to develop solar sailing in the past, but we're not that successful because miniaturization was not yet available. Carl Sagan was the one who actually was pushing for the solar sailing spacecraft within the Planetary Society.
Yeah. In fact, the comet chasing Halley's Comet was an early effort. But this is sort of like the benefits of exponential technology, finally, with the...
Absolutely. See what is happening now? The small spacecraft are getting smaller and more capable. You can pack a lot of electronics in the spacecraft. The Swarm company up in the Bay Area. So they develop a spacecraft with the size of a book, and it provides high bandwidth communication, high data rate communication. It's basically from space, a low Earth orbit, orbiting constellation. And that's now the size of a very capable spacecraft. We benefit from electronic miniaturization. And now with this type of propulsion, which is inexpensive and ever abundant, it's renewable. That's the way to go, actually. And you're right, Neil deGrasse, he and I discussed this basically now we're actually developing with him next step, how to actually to popularize this idea and how to bring more people into this area. Because look, we just realized that technology is available. Now it's the time to actually build the effort so that, first of all, we recognize that it's possible. And there are plenty of users here on Earth or in the solar system for this technology. And so, but doing a solar gravitational lensing, it's something very unique. Imagine that not only exoplanets can be imaged. You can image with the solar gravitational lensing pretty much anything, like quasars. Those objects that are at roughly 12 billion light away from us. They were born just after the universe, after the Big Bang. So the most distant objects. And we never thought about making a resolved image of quasars. With solar gravitational lensing, the image of a quasar is about 500 meters in diameter. And so you can actually fly a spacecraft and image how the quasar works. What is the machine that operates the quasars? Is there a supermassive black hole in the center of the quasar? And what it is? So there are plenty of interesting applications for astrophysics here.
Wow. Yeah. Great.
Interesting. Okay, so is there any limitation, do you think, on the technology of semiconductors development with keeping in mind the high energy particles penetrating this, so it'll be easier to use vacuum tube, they'll be more reliable than
the idea. You're asking about radiation hardened electronics, and
yes,
essentially this type of electronics exist, and those sensors and electronic components, the already available technologies will be sufficient enough for this mission. The challenges for this mission are everywhere unique challenges. The primary challenge, I would say, it's a power. So we need to have a source of power. So once the challenge of long-lasting power will be addressed, we can just populate the solar system with spacecraft. Because as you go beyond the orbit of Jupiter, solar cells are not very capable, right? So mm-hmm. you don't have sun. You need to have something like nuclear energy for that. And so power is challenging, communication is challenging. And essentially there are plenty of other things, but the mission itself, once we address those, we have those things already sort of understood well. Electronic is not a problem there. And so I guess what is maybe the challenge is long duration flight. We're talking about autonomous long duration flight of more than 40 years. So we have never done anything on that Earth that would last, the design would actually last that long, right? Especially electronic components. So most of those.
That's why I'm concerned about it, because once you can design a craft that will be, even if you will say, solve the problem of a long-lasting battery, rechargeable battery, or long-term power source, but then they essentially need to communicate with the satellite.
Absolutely.
Otherwise, it'll be useless, right, for us.
Absolutely. See, the idea here is that we built many of them. Essentially, it's not single spacecraft, so we actually will test those components. Essentially, just a selection strategy. We select the best parts and fly and basically cross fingers in a sense, but not that actually bad. But realistically, there is significant efforts now that actually will improve the technology as we speak. I do expect that maybe within 4 years, those questions will not be really.
Then they could create a sort of a cluster of a swarming cluster of satellites that also, for potentially interesting. Interesting.
And the idea here, we don't fly just single spacecraft, you fly several of them. And essentially, we fly them in something that are called a string of pearls. String of pearls, when you fly one pearl, and that pearl will consist probably within, let's say, 5 to 6 spacecraft. And so because they're inexpensive, you actually fly them, and they fly, let's say, within a couple of years, you fly the second pearl. They will enable you to communicate between the pearls. And so essentially it provides redundancy for the mission. If one spacecraft fails, you have multiple other spacecraft. And so it's now comes down to advanced technologies that you can do to reduce the mass of the spacecraft, reduce the size, and essentially fly as many as you can.
Right. Or essentially by launching many aircraft, many spacecraft, you can mm-hmm. create a mesh, retranslating mesh.
Absolutely, it can be done as well. Right.
Yeah.
You're right. Multiple spacecraft can work as an interferometer. And you can actually use them like a phased array, and potentially there are plenty of other technologies you can use to sort of work to use this the swarm which is available up there. So right. it all comes down to the cost of the spacecraft, right? So if it's a drone-like structure, then the cost becomes kind of it becomes a secondary issue. If it's a major spacecraft, then you have to think how often you fly and what is there. Because we are risk averse. If you fly one spacecraft at a time, we are risk averse. We don't want that spacecraft to fail. We essentially want it to fly and deliver. But if you fly, what is Starlink now is what, 40,000 spacecraft? So each single spacecraft costs a lot, but not that much anymore, because it's an economy of scale that comes in, right? So essentially small spacecraft becomes a commodity, right? And so once it becomes a commodity, you can procure that spacecraft from a vendor.
From AliExpress, yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, you definitely see what I'm saying, because the efforts are now not about the spacecraft bus design. It's different. You build different instruments, and those instruments will be capable, more advanced. But building spacecraft is not that fun anymore, because many people are doing this as we speak.
Okay. Cool. Thanks a lot. That's fantastic. That was very interesting. Anyone else want to ask a question? I saw that Pat was asking question how the objects to be observed. how the objects to be observed be selected. I guess it's about the, yeah.
Yes. This telescope is not good for search for those objects because the field of view of this telescope is extremely small. So those missions that I mentioned at the beginning of my talk that have been developed already in space, they will provide targets. So those targets will be given to this mission. And essentially, once a discovery will be made of the interesting target up there in out there in space, once the discovery will be made, then we will fly that mission. And to repoint this mission to a different target will be difficult until we get nuclear technologies up there, nuclear reactors or fission reactors or something along that line. So, but with this type of, with this approach, we are not thinking about repointing to a different target. Essentially, we consider this mission as looking like studying the entire planetary system. For example, when we fly a spacecraft to Jupiter or Saturn, we are not flying just to study one planet, we're studying the entire planetary satellites, entire system of satellites. So we discover many satellites of Jupiter, many satellites of Saturn. The same will be here. We fly a single mission to study entire system or entire planetary system of that star. And so we'll, for example, TRAPPIST will study in every 8 planets that were discovered recently that orbit that that star. So not only a single planet, but the entire planetary system, plus possibly some planetary satellites. So we can stay there. We can actually study and get the data. Well, once we reach 550 astronomical units away, time is on our side. If mission is healthy and it's sort of operational, basically we are coasting away. We don't need to stop. We're just going away and coasting away from the sun and basically taking data. And we transmit the data, and the data will tell us more about that exoplanet. And that information will be available to everyone. Will basically, each year, the quality of the data will be improving. We'll be seeing more features of that exoplanet. We'll understand how the planet rotates, how long is the, what is the duration of the day of the, on that planet. Are there, you know, oceans? Do we see that this planet has as much water as ours? Or maybe there is only, you know, it's the entire planetary formation story is very interesting. What we discover now from the exoplanetary research, that most of the planets do not look like our own solar system. For example, we discover planets like Jupiter size on the as close to the stars as our Mercury. So Mercury is very tiny rock compared to Jupiter, right? And so this Jupiter is a gas giant which is sitting way out there at 5 astronomical units away. But no, we discover many Jupiters in a very strange position. So we don't really know how those planetary systems actually forming. So there are many questions that we are yet to understand, so which is very exciting. So this area of astronomy is rapidly evolving as more data coming. And at some point, we'll discover those interesting planets that will deserve special attention, and then we'll fly there.
Anyone else? Any other questions? No. Emeline? You wanted to ask something?
No, I think we're good.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I've got to ask one more layman question. Sorry for that. The question is that what I hear is you are concerned mostly with the light amplification by using gravitational lens, right? And you mentioned that there's a, obviously gravitational lens is independent on the wavelength. But what does define the resolution for your image?
What we see now is that because the sun is not perfect sphere, it has some oblateness, right?
Okay, so it's sort of spherical distortion, right?
Spherical distortion. So we do see a color effect. So there will be a wavelength dependence. It's just to answer your first question.
Okay.
But what defines the resolution? It's like traditionally the ratio wavelengths to the diameter of the lens.
That's correct.
In our,
yeah.
in our case, the diameter of the lens is the diameter of the sun. That's amazing. Well, we're talking about nano arc second resolution, which is not even possible now with the classical technologies.
Right.
And so regular telescope, lambda over D, that's what defines resolution. And so what we see through our analysis is that really a good scaling law here will be wavelength divided by roughly by the diameter of the sun. So which is very significant.
Mm-hmm. Oh, thank you. That's interesting. Okay. Well, okay. Well, I can see a lot of very exciting, excited reactions on this talk, and thank you very much for the presentation. I hope we can invite you again, and I guess that will be a lot of different things to discuss. Let's keep in touch.
Absolutely, yeah. We can talk about what is happening with the space industry now. We can what is interesting. So this is amazing revolution that is ongoing. And so many things are happening. And absolutely, I will be happy to. Okay. At some point, I'd love to visit New Zealand. So that will
absolutely.
Be the best
time. Absolutely, come over. We'll be happy to.
Excellent. Thank you very much. And happy 60 years anniversary of the first human space flight.
Happy
activities are just unfolding. Thank you. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye, everybody. Goodbye. Bye-bye.